interpretation of the topic instead of no topic at all. They don't have a counter interpretation, which means the voting half affirms the idea that the half can make any uncontroversial statement about climate identity debate 20 topics ago and win because they introduced the idea first and presented a factual claim versus limits. Their interpretation advises the half to make mega relevant by rushing to the margins of individual experience, small coalitions, single author theories in every vehicle, sector, locals you have on the internet that pushes debate into the net reputation, half monologue, and circumvents developed contradiction. The foundation of argumentation is intangible, but it outweighs their offense because it's not possible to vote on the validity of the one I see that evaded all truth testing. Second is clash. While researched opponents force app arguments to refine it because it makes thousands of cards become worthwhile. The apps that face rigorous opposition improve for the better in the process of retooling their arguments to their best potential, makes debaters effective advocates, and the importance of organizing around environmental impacts outweighs pollution, waste, and coal plants, etc., have multidimensional consequences on the diversity of communities, and ignoring the importance of local organization is worse. Prioritize the tangible link between well-researched climate data and improves environmental outcomes over their vague solvency mechanism. It also turns the app because it's impossible to cohere around innovative value structure or determine their worth if we can't test it to begin with. Their first argument is that the ballot changes debate. It's not true of the ballot in this debate. They don't have a unique reason why voting AF changes a structure that exists in the community writ large. We don't recognize that after this debate ends, nothing about our arguments to engagement going forward has likelihood to be drastically altered, which is why this debate has to be model versus model, because it's the only way to determine what we've presented as a way of approaching the topic versus the AF. Their next argument is topicality controls what they discuss. First is it's an arbitrary method because it means that any contradiction links to their argument. We haven't said that what they discuss or how they talk about it is wrong, but rather the stasis point for the ballot in this debate should be something that has to do with contradiction, which brings me to my second argument, which is that we have not said that any individual can only talk about a certain thing or that they don't belong in this space or that individual identities are not welcome, but rather the way we should decide who wins or who lost should be based on controversial issues that allow nonviolent confrontation between the AF and the NED, which also answers their next argument that we silence them as individuals because it's not about individual identity. It's about the stasis point over which you decide the ballot. They say stasis excludes them, but it's the same response. It's not an individual, it's an argument. Debate over individuals is worse. We shouldn't do it, including identifying the judges as white or voting for Rutgers because they identify as black is bad. That interpretation of debate incentivizes the AF to talk about the most personal issues because it's what's most difficult to concentrate. To make the NED have nothing to say or only personal attacks, which is more violent, causes forced identity disclosure, incentivizes people to lie and misrepresent their identity. It turns all of their offense because it reinforces structural unfairness and exclusion. It puts judges in an untenable position because debates are based on things like ad hoc attacks, when we were last judged, how things like preps play out. Their next argument is that the AF is accessible. They haven't identified an argument, a method of contradiction, etc. All that they've said is they shouldn't have to tell us how we can contradict them, and then they've said that any contradiction is bad because it imposes psychological violence. That is our whole point. There has to be some model of contradiction because the NED has a burden of rejoinder to be able to say emissions restrictions are good even if there's some contradiction. It doesn't answer any of our predictability offense. Their next argument is structural fairness. We don't make debate less fair. Their interpretation only makes it more biased towards the AF and big schools who have the capacity to do tons of research. It's also not a reason to vote AF because it's not something that they solve. It's not something that's intrinsic to T, especially with the topical version of the AF. Go there now. You can do it sufficiently dividends. You can ban pollution in predominantly black communities, ban cheap fossil fuels for rich white-owned companies, or ban fossil fuels for the period to shut down the state. Obviously, these provide the NED with some offense, but they don't make distinct scholarship, racial issues, or social concerns irrelevant. Considering these arguments advance real-world concerns like econ and energy is worthwhile. We don't have to win it solves 100% of the case because that's the whole point of having a topic that's rife with contradiction, but it forces us to have some form of value discussion that's focused around some point of controversy. The next argument is that presumption is anti-black. It's not. There's nothing about saying that if we don't change anything, we shouldn't vote for it. They concede a lot of our productivity answers. They link to it because they also ask to win debates, speak fast, do research, and cite authors of all productivity, including the idea that debate in the AF contradicts the NED is worthless. Then you should vote NED because there was never any debate to be had. Our productivity arguments also aren't focused on individuals. They're just focused on the burden of rejoinder. Their last argument is that voting AF forces us to have a conversation about violence. We've indicted the idea that that should be what determines the ballot because it just creates more violence. Now, the case. Their first argument is that we should interrogate labor relations. One is the AF doesn't solve it as a blood structure because they can't front institutions writ large. The second argument is that we shouldn't vote that way based on individual value, which was the T debate. Their next two arguments about collective action among black people and self-care for individuals. That is our entire point. If the NED is forced to say no, you shouldn't have self-care, or yes, you should not say no to the way the resolution relates to you. It's simply impossible because it's either fucked or fucked up for us to say you shouldn't approach the topic in this way for yourself, or we just don't have any arguments. Their next two arguments about how they know individuals also link to this offense. Their next argument is that not working within the system is bad. There's no link to their state bad offense that presumes they become a part of the state, because her argument is simply that they can make a normative statement that the state should not do bad climate policy and discuss how that's affected by individuals. Don't think about our interpretation precludes discussions of debate. It just precludes it as the basis for which you decide who wins or lost. The K, I'm not going for the alt, but there's some solvency arguments. First, his expression is always focused on labor, even if they create new forms of intrinsic value. That space for valuation only exists as a result of material positions. Two is using the act to contest structures fields. It prioritizes certain forms of actions which are still externally defined. Three is the starting point of the self is worst, which is also offense against the idea that debate should be about individuals. It creates pedagogy where experience is freely circulating with no mechanism to address how the material shapes those decisions, which proves why expression and uniqueness will always bloom before organizing, and we can't confront institutions, which is another link to our offense about coalescing around environmental issues. Lastly, its survival strategies presume the world can't be changed, which is why they try to act against it. It leads people to focus only on the self and never what can be done to change the system, which also links to our offense, but we have to have a topic right with contradiction.
So here at the end of the negative speeches, we're going to start putting on our judge hat. The way that works is the judge starts conceptualizing an RFD in their mind, starts asking themselves questions, then searching their flow and recollection for answers to those questions. It would go something like this. What is the offense Georgetown wants me to vote on? The answer is maintaining a role for the negative. Debates must have two reasonable sides. There must be contradiction. Without that, and when it is replaced with debates on how individuals should respond to things external to themselves, that has perverse consequences. Personal attacks, identity disclosure, lying, etc. Okay, so what does Rutgers want me to vote on? As of the 1AR, they want me to endorse the AF as a strategy to help respond to instances of psychological violence, provide self-care, respond to silencing, and challenge toxic masculinity in and outside of debate. Okay, so as of the 2NR, what has Georgetown told me about why Rutgers' story is wrong? One, forcing us to contradict how individuals should deal with issues is bad. Okay, so what did Rutgers say about that? They said the ask impacts are more important and other debates prove engagement is possible. Okay, so what did Georgetown say about this other debates thing? Not really anything in the 2NR, but did have some stuff about this is not as good a way to decide debates as model versus model. That was their argument in the 2NC. They said model versus model in the 2NR, but it was in the context of debating about individuals, not really in the context of this other debates argument. Two, T is not exclusion. What did Rutgers say about that argument? They said it was exclusion. For a few different reasons. Mainly, it's an example of opposing black women, which was what the crux of the 1AC was about. So what did Georgetown say about that? Mainly, this response proves their point about negative contradiction and how the AF makes it untenable. They supplemented that argument with an impact comparison argument about truth testing and why vote AF if the debate was a monologue or not a viable debate in the first place. The other thing Georgetown said was that they're talking about arguments, not individuals, and nothing is being said to be off-limits, but rather determining what should factor into the win-loss calculation for the judges. Three, topical plans facilitate these conversations better. Rutgers said that they divert focus and make the debate about something more trivial. They promote silencing. They also said that the conversations highlighted in the affirmative need to be forefronted, and accountability should be enforced via wins and losses through the ballot. Georgetown, in response, says those discussions can happen, but you shouldn't necessarily win a debate because of them. The explanation was couched in debating about arguments is good, debating about individuals is bad. Georgetown also said the topical version doesn't have to be perfect to solve the role for the neg and avoid the fact that Rutgers promotes debating about individuals. On this ballot key argument, Georgetown says that these claims to solvency are empirically denied. So with all of that circulating, what can we sketch for a 2AR? I would say it would go like this. First, emphasize the uniqueness portion of the debate. The neg does not have a counter-explanation. This is how the world and debate relate to black women. Second, highlight a particular impact to that and compare it to Georgetown's claims about negative ground. Third, explain solvency, since a lot of the secondary stuff in the 2NR is couched in no solvency terms. Four, explain the distinctions about T not being exclusion and this notion of separating arguments from individuals is untenable. This doesn't get Georgetown out of linking to the 1AC, but potentially magnifies the issue, particularly as it relates to black women who potentially have a very difficult time making it so people distinguish their arguments from their identity or their individuality. Fifth, explain how other debates disprove their engagement claims, Georgetown's engagement claims. Explain how those other debates, without using framework or topicality, do promote good engagement. And then finally, explain how topical debates don't solve the impact you highlighted at the top. Let's see if that is how the 2AR goes.